everyone. I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines. Wall Street ends a rocky month of June with the S&P 500 posting its worst first half slide since 1970. Asian shares set for a higher open. Here at home, the PSE index kicks off from 61.55 as the country welcomed a new president. Ron Acoba of Trading Edge joins us for his market outlook. Balay ni Frutas skids on its PSE debut yesterday. We speak with Calvin Chua of Balay ni Frutas on why the company remains bullish despite dire market conditions. Plus, some exciting M&A news. And the Philippine Central Bank says inflation likely accelerated between 5.7 and 6.5% in June. We begin with financial markets. Wall Street ended lower on Thursday as it crosses the finish line of a grim month. The S&P 500 fell 0.8%, capping its worst first half slide since 1970. It's down 21% since hitting an all-time high in January. Meanwhile, the tech-heavy Nasdaq dropped 1.3% and is now down 22% for the second quarter. The Dow lost 253 points. Rising inflation has been behind much of the slump this year, with the consumer price index in the U.S. running at its hottest pace in more than 40 years. The Federal Reserve and other central banks have been aggressively rising interest rates to try to cool inflation. But while higher rates can bring down inflation, they also risk choking growth and triggering a recession. Economic data released on Thursday did little to allay recession fears. Disposable income in the U.S. inching lower and consumer spending decelerated. But U.S. jobless claims fell slightly last week to 231,000, a sign the labor market remains tight. Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all the major indices pointing to a muted open when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Now, over here in Asia, markets are in the green on the first day of the new month and quarter. Australia's ASX 200 so far leading the gains there, up by nearly 0.5%. South Korea's Kospi Index is up 0.5%, while Japan's Nikkei 225 is, well, struggling for direction after sentiment at large manufacturers in the country worsened in the second quarter. The Bank of Japan's Tankan Business Sentiment Survey showed the headline index for large manufacturer sentiment came in at 9 points. That is a decline from the previous quarter's reading of 14 amid high inflation. The MSCI World Stock Index posting its biggest first half percentage drop on record. It fell about 0.5%, bringing its year-to-date losses to more than 20% amid concerns about the Ukraine-Russia war, soaring inflation, rising interest rates, and more recently, a possible U.S. recession. Looking at interesting corporate stories now, Facebook owner Meta Platforms bracing for a leaner second half of this year as it copes with macroeconomic pressures and data privacy hits to its ads business. In an internal memo seen by Reuters, its chief product officer said the company needed to execute better in an environment of slower growth where teams should not expect vast influxes of new engineers and budgets. We're also looking at Barclays, which is giving 35,000 of its staff in Britain a $1,450 annual pay raise to help ease the impact of the cost of living crisis. The pay rise will take effect on August 1st. And the U.S. Federal Communications Commission has authorized Elon Musk's SpaceX to use its Starlink satellite internet network with moving vehicles. This greenlights the company's plan to expand broadband offerings to commercial airlines, shipping vessels, cruises, and trucks. The Philippine Central Bank sees inflation accelerating further in June. The BSP expects the consumer price index to settle within the range of 5.7 to 6.5%. That is way above government's target range of 2 to 4% and even higher than the 5.4% inflation recorded in May. The BSP cites the continued increase in oil and power prices as well as the peso's depreciation as the primary sources of inflationary pressures for the month. The central bank has raised its benchmark interest rates twice this year to 2.5% in a bid to tame hot inflation. Lester Hughes Balay ni Frutas, the baked goods subsidiary of his kiosk business Frutas Holdings, braved the market volatility on Thursday And while that courage wasn't richly rewarded by investors during debut, the company is bullish about fundamentals and a new acquisition. For more on this, Calvin Chua of Frutas and Balay ni Frutas joins us this morning. Calvin, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Good morning again, Mimi.
Congratulations on yesterday. You did brave the wild swings of the market. You pushed through with your 309 million peso IPO. However, because of overall sentiment of the market, the stock finished lower by 7%. I guess my question is, why didn't you wait or just defer the IPO like the others did? I mean, do you need this money badly?
Not to say that we needed it badly. We have enough cash resources, and our internal cash generation is fast improving. But we see a lot of opportunities in this market. Again, we are looking at a more than $6 billion market in terms of baked goods. And we would like to, you know, have the bullets when they are presented to us.
That's my next question, actually. Why should your investors be bullish, just like you?
Okay. First off, baked goods actually increased during the pandemic. So I would say this is a pandemic-proof business. Second, we are just currently in the counter service segment. There are other segments that we are looking into, including modern trade. Not to say that we will just enter, but we will be very disciplined in evaluating opportunities. As you would know, the leaders in that segment are mostly multinationals. So I think the Philippines would be quite excited to have a national champion, a local national champion like us.
But for those who have been following Lester Yu's growing empire, this is the second listed company for Mr. Yu. The first one was Frutas Holdings, the parent, which is the kiosk business. It's still below IPO price. What's keeping the price down, you think?
I think, the overall market sentiment. Mm-hmm. Second, I think the subsidiaries are still not valued properly. Mm-hmm. Because, they are not liquid, right? But I would say each of our subsidiaries are gaining strength. Jamaican Patty, for example, with the coming with the movies coming back and a lot of blockbusters line up, is sure to have more demand. Mm-hmm. We also have Sabroso Lechon, hotels are reopening. Our beverage business is quite resilient in the sense that we had a very good summer. And during this wet season, we will have other refreshment offerings to counter, let's say, flu or colds, right? So we have our lemonade, we have our calamansi juice, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm.
And you're confident that the consumers are ready to, revenge spend on these things?
It's not necessarily revenge spend, but it's a continuation of mm-hmm. the healthy trend that happened during the pandemic, and people are going towards value for money. We are in that sweet spot where we believe people are willing to spend for our products because they deliver value and they see the benefits of our consuming our product. Mm-hmm.
So the 309 million you raised in yesterday's IPO, how will that money be deployed? How far can it go before you find the need to go back to the capital markets to raise even more money?
Yeah. So out of that 288.8 million mm-hmm. Pesos that was raised, that was at the 0.70 final price, about 204 million will be net proceeds for primary. That will be used towards store network expansion. Mm-hmm. So 80% will be used towards network store network expansion, focusing primarily on Balay Pandesal. And we have the remaining 20% split equally between potential acquisitions as well as a set of commissaries. And I would like to emphasize this that this would be supplemented by our internal cash generation and strong internal, we have our internal cash resources.
Mm-hmm. That's good to know. Balay, which used to be Balay Nipan de Sal, was actually an acquisition by Frutas back in 2021, a pandemic time. Magnificent story for investors there. And I know you have another interesting acquisition in the wings. I think you're ready to share the good news. So what's the new acquisition for Frutas? So this is the parent, right?
Yes. So Fruit, we just posted on the PSE. Mm-hmm. So this is fresh off the oven at 8:37 a.m. So we actually use our Soy Kingdom subsidiary to acquire shares of LN Banawe and certain assets related to the Lingnam restaurant group in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. Now, this allows us, again, as I previously mentioned in your show, to really focus each of our subsidiaries into a specific segment. And we believe that Asian food is a big segment, right? If you look at, the restaurants in any of the malls, it's primarily Chinese, Japanese, Thai, and so on. So Filipinos really gravitate toward Asian food. So we are supplementing the 55-store network that we had built, again, through a previous acquisition, the Tofu Store, which was rebranded into Soy and Bean, with Lingnam. And we are very excited. This is a 72-year-old brand, which we believe, has wings and has a strong following among Filipino Chinese as well as the, general market in general. I mean, I've actually asked a few friends from Singapore, from Japan to taste it, and that's something that they say is very authentic Cantonese food.
Yeah, I know that a lot of our friends from the Filipino Chinese community grew up eating Lingnam, depending on which branch, whether you're in Banawe or you're in Binondo. But very quick question on this acquisition. You said you're acquiring shares of Lingnam. Is it a majority stake you're buying? And can you tell us the price tag for the deal?
It's 100% of the shares of LN Banawe. So that's the one which houses the Lingnam store in Banawe and other assets, so including IP, including equipment, commissary, etc. So we would have the whole business lock, stock, and barrel. We intend to, as in previous our previous acquisitions, we intend to take advantage of synergies within the group. So we have our Soy Kingdom, Soy and Bean, which provides soy-based products. That's a natural fit with Lingnam. And you will soon see chillers of, if you've not already seen them, in Lingnam stores. So Frutas coconut juice, soy and bean, soy milk, and more.
Is there only one branch of Lingnam left?
Currently, there are two main branches.
So the other branch,
T. Alonzo is part of the asset acquisition.
Everything. So it's the whole Lingnam branch.
Yes, it's shares and assets covering the whole Lingnam restaurant.
All right, and the price tag for the deal?
Okay, I could not say, but it's still below 10% of our net assets.
Okay, which is the threshold? So, yeah.
Yes, because we, as you've seen, this is our fourth acquisition during the pandemic. I wouldn't say it's a specialty, but something we look after our bigger brothers, let's say in Jollibee, right? Or Shakey's, we're not the largest, so we start with small acquisitions and we grow them organically.
Calvin, you did say that this is your fourth acquisition during the pandemic. Are there more in the pipeline? Are you in talks for more brands at least? How many more?
There are, but the guidance, general guidance, is that each of our subsidiaries, again, we would like to really maximize it. So we have another subsidiary called Coco Delivery, right, which has the fleet to deliver our goods to different, to the customer segments. So, I mean, what the Vogue thing, I wouldn't say it's something that will pass, right? Dark kitchens, cloud kitchens is something that we are looking into quite deeply. We see this as a trend that will, persist.
Dark kitchens, cloud kitchens, looks like expansion is really happening within the brand. Just very quickly, though, the peso is getting weaker. Has this impacted your costs for some of your raw materials, for your operations? I can imagine some of your materials are imported.
Yes. So flour, for example, is largely imported. I mean,
I'm
not sure actually if there's Philippine sources. Lemons, for example, are imported, although there are some small local sources. Again, we are watching these closely. Anything that affects our margins are watched closely. We have a monitoring within our purchasing team, which tracks all of these prices, what our expectations are, what the potential demand is. So we match demand and supply. We do have a lot of data points to work off from. Pre-pandemic, we were doing like 100,000 transactions. So there's a lot of data that we can work off from, and that's something that we intend to make use of.
All right. And final question. It's essentially you spun off Balaini Frutas. Are there plans to do the same to your other subsidiaries?
If there are suitable partners who can provide value to each of our subsidiaries, again, we would not shy away from those talks. There are a lot of opportunities in the F&B space, starting from QSR all the way to big goods, which we just listed right yesterday. We are at a good place where we have the bullets. It's now up to us whether we pull the trigger.
All right. On that note, Calvin, thank you very much for sharing the good news. Congratulations again. We're going to be watching the exciting developments coming from your company. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, moving on to more news. OPEC and its allies stick to a planned output increase in August, defying calls to pump more barrels to cool crude prices. The group will increase monthly overall production for August to 648,000 barrels per day. OPEC Plus has been slowly returning the nearly 10 million barrels per day it pulled from the market back in April 2020 when the pandemic hit demand. Oil prices slipped on Thursday after OPEC's decision and amid concerns about global supply tightness. International benchmark Brent crude fell to $114 a barrel, while U.S. crude settled at $108 a barrel. Public utility vehicle drivers not satisfied with the latest 2 peso fare hike granted by transport regulators. This report from Lady Vicencio.
The 2 peso fare hike for public utility jeepneys will be implemented across the country on July 1st. Base fare will be at 11 pesos in Metro Manila, Region 3 and 4. For modern jeepneys, minimum fare nationwide will be at 13 pesos. But for many jeepney drivers, the fare increase is hardly enough. Public utility drivers argue a meager fare adjustment will not offset the soaring cost of fuel and basic needs.
Yung diesel natin, ma'am, nasa mga 90 plus na, ma'am, eh. Tapos, ma'am, yung pasahero, madalang. Parang wala din nangyari.
Ang provisional increase po na hinihingi nila based on the omnibus motion that they filed last June 23 was a 2 pesos na provisional increase. So, kumbaga, nung June 8, they were already given 1 peso. So, ang dinagdag natin ngayon, 1 peso na lang for NCR, Region 3 and Region 4.
Transport Group Piston believes a number of jeepney drivers who changed livelihood because of rising oil prices might return behind the wheel. A commuters group agrees with the fare hike, but more needs to be done to help the transport sector.
Kung sa amin po ay maluwag namin tinatanggap yan, pero dahil po naiintindihan din po namin ang tunay na kalagayan ng drivers, ang inaasahan po namin din ay maging 12 pesos. Dahil nga yung computation yan, lumalabas po na ang kanilang, ang idinagdag lang natin sa pang-araw-araw na kanilang kita ay 5 liters. Kulang pa rin yung idinagdag natin.
But not all passengers welcome the fare adjustment, saying any increase is an expense they can do without.
Malaking bagay na po. Parehas ko po, tatlong sakay.
Pag kinumpit po yun sa loob ng isang buwan, malaking bagay rin po sa budget po sana namin. Yan ba sa amin po ng mga nagtatrabaho, malaking bagay rin pong pandagdag sa pangkain namin po yan.
Transport regulators have yet to decide on fare hike petitions for taxis, TNVS, and buses, which will now be decided on by the Marcos administration. Lady Vicentio, ABS-CBN News.
Now here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today, Friday. Indonesia will post its June inflation print. Consumer prices in Indonesia rose to 3.55% in May, the highest reading since December 2017, as food prices rose sharply. The Philippines also coming out with its second quarter consumer confidence numbers. Consumers in the country were less pessimistic in the first 3 months of the year, with the confidence index increasing to -15.1%. That is the highest figure since the first quarter of 2020 due to the availability of more jobs amid the improving pandemic situation. And the euro area will also report its June inflation figures. The eurozone's inflation rate rose to a record high of 8.1% in May amid a broad-based increase in prices, with energy and food making the biggest upward pressure. Chinese President Xi Jinping ready to work with the Philippines' new leader. In his congratulatory letter, Xi told Ferdinand Marcos Jr. that he is willing to work with him to continue writing a great chapter of China-Philippine relations. Chinese Vice President Wang Qixian, who represented Xi during Thursday's inauguration, also presented a four-point proposal to enhance bilateral ties. According to Chinese state media CCTV, Marcos told Wang that Beijing was Manila's most powerful partner and that his administration is willing to deepen the country's participation in China's Belt and Road Initiative. There was no mention of China's increased military activities in disputed waters, but Japanese Foreign Minister Yoshimasa Hayashi, who also met with Marcos, said the Philippine leader agreed to cooperate with Tokyo to maintain and reinforce rules-based maritime order. Hayashi added Japan will support the Philippines' effort to enhance equipment of its Coast Guard. During his inaugural address on Thursday, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. vowed to complete ongoing infrastructure projects during his term. This after former President Rodrigo Duterte appealed to his successor to continue the projects that had been started. Marcos also praised his father's and Duterte's infrastructure programs.
My father built more and better roads, produced more rice than all administrations before his. President Rodrigo Roa Duterte built more and better than all the administrations succeeding my father's. Following these giant steps, we will continue to build. I will complete on schedule the projects that have been started. I'm not interested in taking credit. I want to build on success that's already happening. We will be presenting the public with a comprehensive infrastructure plan. 6 years could be just about enough time.
Marcos also said the Philippines can find a way around its energy supply problems. He also hinted at his preference for renewable energy, even claiming he built the windmills in Ilocos Norte.
We have yet to see large-scale practical solutions to pollution, though some are beginning to emerge. But there are tried and proven new ways of mitigation. Blades have been turning over the sand dunes of Ilocos Norte, harnessing a power all around, but unseen, long before this day. I built them.
In an interview with ANC in 2010, Marcos also acknowledged the wind farm was a private commercial enterprise. The Bangi windmills were developed and constructed by the North Wind Power Development Corporation. Rodrigo Duterte back in Davao City after turning over the Philippine presidency to Bongbong Marcos. Duterte's commercial flight arrived at the Davao City International Airport on Thursday evening, where a water salute was done as a tribute to the former chief executive. He also attended a homecoming concert held by his supporters. But before his exit from Malacañang, he made an appeal to Filipinos to support his successor. Bia Gutierrez has this report.
36 years after his family was ousted from Malacañang, Ferdinand Marcos Jr. finally returns to the palace, this time as the 17th president of the Philippines. Following the tradition of those who came before him, Marcos Jr. first went to Malacañang Thursday morning to meet with his predecessor, Rodrigo Duterte, a symbol of a peaceful transition of power between the incoming and outgoing leaders. Marcos Jr. arrived at the palace a few minutes before 10:30 in the morning, where he was greeted by Duterte on top of the palace staircase. From here, Marcos Jr. signed the palace guestbook, his name and signature being the last entry for the Duterte administration. The mood between the two leaders was cordial and cheerful, despite Duterte calling his successor a spoiled brat and weak leader months earlier. The meeting, however, lasted less than 10 minutes, after which they both descended the grand staircase and into the Kalayaan grounds, where Duterte was given his last honors as President of the Philippines. Had the tradition been followed, the outgoing president would have accompanied his successor all the way to the inaugural venue, where he would be given his last honors, signaling the end of his term and a return to his life as an ordinary citizen. Duterte, however, did not follow this tradition, choosing instead to leave from Malacañang after a quick goodbye to the members of his cabinet. Marcos Jr. then proceeded to the National Museum without his predecessor. In an earlier video, however, Duterte expressed his support for the new administration as he urged the public to help Marcos Jr.
Let us give all our support to the new administration. Tulungan natin. Tulungan natin.
Meanwhile, prior to his return to Davao City on board a commercial flight, the former president spent his first hours as citizen digong by going to a mall in Makati. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
Up next, to look at the opening numbers at the Philippine Stock Exchange following Thursday's slump, Ron Acoba of Trading Edge Consultancy joins us for some market perspective after the break. Market Edge, we'll be right back. Inflation likely accelerated between 5.7% and 6.5% in June. And some properties of motel chain Victoria Court rebrands into Hotel Ava. We speak with Hotel Ava owner Angie Mead King later on in the show for more on that. The Philippine Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 61.55. Right now it's up by 0.4%, 23 points, 61.77. Joining us today for his take on the markets, Ron Acoba of Trading Edge Consultancy. Ron, hi, good morning.
Hi, Mimi. Good to see you.
All right. Ron, just very quickly, I want to start with a peso. It seems like it's the bigger story. The Philippine peso has been teetering on the brink of the 55 to the dollar handle. It finished on Thursday at 54.975. When you've got the former BSP governor, now finance secretary, Ben Jokno, saying, oh, nothing to worry. Weak peso is good for OFWs. A strong peso only benefits the rich. And then you've got the new BSP governor saying, you know, if we see the exchange rate overshooting too much and that selling Forex won't make the problem go away, we would consider increasing policy rates by more than the planned 25 bips. How alarmed should the markets be at this point?
Actually, what you want to see from the peso is for it to really stabilize. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter if it stabilizes at, say, 50 peso level or it stabilizes at around 55 peso level. What is important is for it to be, you know, predictable and stable. So, well, given the comments of the former head of the BSP, signaling that at least on his term, he's not too keen in increasing our benchmark interest rate. this is in contrary to the position of the upcoming upcoming BSP head. So we have to establish the direction of our monetary policy for us to see if we're going to see an improvement in the position of the peso relative to the US dollar. Of course, the former BSP head is correct in stating that a weak peso will benefit, for example, the tourism industry, our export sector, our remittances. But in terms of hot money investments, in terms of say investments in the stock market, investment in the fixed income market, a stable peso relative to the US dollar is actually very, very, very crucial.
Mm-hmm. What is stable for you? I mean, what is a wild swing? What is a stable movement?
Well,
the peso is already down 8% year to date.
Exactly. The peso is down 8% year to date. It's down 15% since the end of 2020. So in that sense, the peso is really not stable at all. Stable means you can, it's like trading within a band of say 50, between 50 and 53, or a 10% band at least in a time span of like say a year or two. Mm-hmm. That's stable because it gives foreign investors to go ahead to invest and take that exchange rate risk into consideration. Mm-hmm. With regards to their investments.
Technicals wise though, Ron, where's the Philippine peso headed in the next 6 to 8 months? What are the charts telling you?
Unfortunately, at least from a technical point of view, the exchange rate has already breached its 2018 high of 54. So it's now headed towards its 2004 high and I believe all-time peak of around 56 to 57.72.
All right. Can I get that again? The number that you mentioned earlier?
The next key resistance for the USD/PHP exchange rate would be its 2004 high of around 56 to 57.72.
56 to 57.72. All right. Hopefully we're not alarming investors who are watching us, but that's what the charts are saying. So I guess the next question is connecting it to the stocks. How much of this peso headline is to blame for the poor performance of the stock market? I mean, how much of that is the peso and how much is just overall poor sentiment? Because it seems like, for those watching closely, the PSE index is recognizing lower lows at 6,100. Is
yeah,
the market,
exactly,
you think, priced as if the recession is already here?
Well, it's actually one of the major catalysts, at least for the last several weeks. As of yesterday, the PSEI is down 16%. Year to date, it was down as much as 20% last week from its 2022 high of 7.75. For the next several weeks, as you've mentioned, it's quite obvious that we might see further decline in the index. We might even see new yearly lows in the index. Of course, the main catalyst would be the ongoing monetary policy tightening in the U.S. as they try to stem the surge in their inflation, which reached a 40-year high of, I believe, 8.6%, 8.6% in May. So for the coming month, what's the driving force of negative sentiment and weakness in the peso is the fact that the Fed had been aggressively increasing their benchmark interest rates. In fact, for the present month, the US Fed is actually expected to hike by another 75 basis points to 2.5%, matching our own interest rate, and to further hike it to as much as 3.75% at the end of the year. Take note that the Philippine sovereign risk should reflect a risk premium and therefore a higher interest rate compared to that of the US, since the July hike of the US Fed would essentially bring it equal to that of the BSP. That's actually one of the main reasons why foreigners remain to be sellers of local risk assets. They remain to be sellers of hot money investments, both in fixed income, equities, and currencies, because they will essentially get the same yield with lesser risk just by positioning and going away from the Philippines and going back to the US. Also, there's no impetus for foreigners to hold into an asset whose currency is depreciating.
Mm-hmm. Wow. You know, for all the talk about decoupling from the US, it seems we continue to dance to the tune that the US is singing. But I guess for investors watching, when will this go away? When do you see a turning point, at least, when the good news comes flowing back in?
Well, for in terms of monetary policies, at least the BSP has signified that it's not going to match the hike of the US Fed point by point. So you can say that from that end, the BSP is more on the dovish end, while for the US Fed side, they are really keen in stemming their inflation and in hiking their interest rates. So the cue for when will this thing improve would be the time when the US Fed slows down their interest rate increases. Hopefully by fourth quarter of this year, we see a slowdown in the way that they hike their benchmark interest rates.
All right, keeping our fingers crossed with you. Let's go over some interesting corporate stories now. We have this just in from today. We interviewed Frutas Holdings. Balaini Frutas raised around 290 million net proceeds from the IPO yesterday. Its shares finished lower by 7%. But here's the news that we got this morning. They were actually buying the parent. Frutas Holdings is buying Lingnam, 100% of the Lingnam brand. Quick comment on that.
Well, I'm not really sure if buying restaurants such as Lingnam, which is into a different category, I mean, at least in terms of branding, is part of their prospectus. If it is, then that would be a good growth area. But if it's not, then it will be the same as when Frutas intended to buy a hospital, which is a totally different segment from
mm-hmm. That didn't push through.
That hospital didn't push through.
They were saying that they're going to house this. It's Soy Kingdom. Their unit Soy Kingdom is the subsidiary that they use to buy Lingnam. So it's more Asian food. I guess the question is, do M&A still excite investors when you've got a company growing, not organically, but through M&As? Is that still as exciting as it was?
Well, presently it is, because given the result of the pandemic, there are a lot of companies that are needing an infusion of capital, whether from their peers or from a bigger listed company. We've seen that previously with CNPF buying, let's say, Potato Corner and the like. So M&As is definitely an area to look into.
All right. Shopee Linked, more stories. Shopee Linked Sea and Shore has entered the Philippine market. It actually bought two local players, AA Guarantee Assurance and Reliance Surety and Insurance. Century Pacific is allotting 2 billion pesos in capex. It's actually down 20%. But they're confident their top line will still post double-digit growth despite rising inflation. Ron, when you've got listed companies announcing that their capex are going down, that's a forward indicator that's not really positive, is it?
Well, yes. Precisely because of the fact that their main cost in operation, which is, you know, cost of goods sold, are rising and eating up their margin. So the prudent thing during this environment is to really limit your capex, and then to just expand it when everything gets back to normal later on.
All right. Speaking of expansion, Double Dragon seems like it can't wait. Its international unit has signed a land deal for a Hotel 101 in Hokkaido, Japan. What do you make of this story?
Well, it's surprising that they're entering, or well, expanding overseas that quickly. Locally, they have a lot of areas that they can. I would expect them to enter into different areas locally first before they expand internationally. Mm-hmm. So,
Okay, that's we'll just see how that pans out. San Miguel Corporation Unit is ready to deploy 500 megawatt hours of battery energy storage system facilities. They're hoping to hit 700 by year end. So it's an energy play again. And finally, the Philippines' total savings further fell to 3.8 trillion pesos, down 12% in 2021. And DFNN and Nautilus to build green data centers in Bataan. Are you betting big on the data center plays?
Well, as of now, presently, data centers in general are still a small sector in the country. But given how technology is moving forward, data centers would be logical. In fact, a lot of major corporations, for example, Globe, PLDT, Ayala Land, are foraying into that particular segment as we speak. So at least for them, they're seeing growth in that particular segment.
All right. We've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. And talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. I believe this is a stock or a company that you think is a good inflation hedge. Is that correct?
Well, inflation hedge because of the fact that the stock was up despite all that's happening in the country. Well, a little clue. It's a third liner, so it's a little bit speculative from that end. But it is a company that is headed by the cousin of the new president. So
all right.
That would be a giveaway if you look at that. It's down 18% in the last 3 to 4 days, but on a year-to-date basis, despite its decline in the past few days, it's still up by more than 100%. So technically, though, if you look at its long-term chart, multi-year chart, it appears to be completing a long-term base. But what needs to happen, though, at least from a technical perspective, is for it to consolidate and move sideways, mm-hmm. and then for it to hurdle its recent resistance of 3.5. Should it do that, then we can see perhaps another major run, much like how it performed in the present year.
All right, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Thank you very much, Ron, for joining us. Have a great weekend.
Thank you, Mimi.
All right. Now, Philippine factory activity slips in June as inflationary pressures remain sharp. The country's June PMI came in at 53.8, a decline from May's 54.1. But it still signals expansion, S&P Global says, while the reading indicated a solid improvement in operating conditions across manufacturing firms, rising fuel prices and inflationary pressures continued to weigh on business expectations. Factory activity in other ASEAN countries also showed a slowing down last month, except in Malaysia, where production levels stabilized for the first time following 5 consecutive monthly declines. Businesswoman Angie Mead King celebrated Pride Month by rebranding some Victoria Court properties to set an example for employers to embrace radical changes in policies. And she joins us this morning to talk about that. Hi, Angie. Welcome to Market Edge.
Hi, Mimi. Thanks for having us. Hello to the viewers also.
All right. So you're rebranding 3 Victoria Court properties to Hotel Ava, the ones in Malate,
yes.
Buendia, and Pasay, as you dare to be different here. Hashtag dare to be different here. From a motel chain to sustainable tourism. How will that work?
Well, so me and my brother share the same brand. And, you know, after the pandemic, we had so much learning in terms of not wanting to go back to business as usual. Actually, we were studying to rebrand already 2018, and we said it wasn't the right time. But because during the pandemic, I shut the company down, it was a good chance for us to revisit all the policies, all the programs, all the how we work internally. So we realized that the employees wanted to spend more time with their staff. So we ended up crunching down the work weeks, giving more leaves for paternity and maternity leaves.
Wow.
And then we also wanted to carry on some sustainable programs. As you can see, the Green Wall project that we're so busy trying to interconnect and fill up. We also have rainwater collection system, excuse me, and yes, that's the Malate branch that you see right here. But yes, just trying to revisit how we treat the employees, how we treat the community, and how we treat the environment.
Mm-hmm. But more than the branding, will the model change? Will Hotel Ava no longer be a motel chain?
Well, I can't veer away far from our current market. I mean, the current market is that in itself, where that is the demand for the business. So no, but I think we will appeal also to a lot of environmentally conscious people. So I think maybe adding on to the market rather than changing the market completely. Mm.
And why Hotel Ava? I'm very curious. What's with the name?
So we wanted a short and sweet name, a classy name, and then something that we could make a logo with, because the Victoria Court logo is such a powerful, iconic logo, mm-hmm. and we wanted something to at least be memorable in that sense, because it's hard to compete with this logo, and Ava was it. And you can't mispronounce it. Ava or Ava sounds good.
All right. And just to clarify, the three branches that have rebranded are the ones under your management. What about the ones, the properties under your brother, Atticus? That would be seven other properties, right?
Yes, it still remains as Victoria Court.
All right. Are there plans to move to the rebranded Ava, Hotel Ava, for the seven others?
No, because so a lot of people don't know this, but when my dad started working also under my grandfather, it was only Anita Lodge, and he didn't want to compete with his brother, so he ended up opening Victoria Court. Ah. So Anita became my brother, my uncles, and then Victoria Court became my father. So we're sort of following the same suit, because me and my brother have very different management styles. How we treat our employees are very different also. So rather than try to align and be the same in terms of systems, we've decided to branch out, and that's what I've done.
All right. Talk to us about how the business is doing right now. We're about 3 years into the pandemic, reopening mode. Are you starting to see the big travel boom, the accommodations boom that we were all expecting and hoping for this year? Are you at least breaking even at this point?
I would say the local market is on an uptrend, but we're still not the same as the 2019 year. For my hotel in Manila, La Corona, which actually still closed. So Hotel La Corona is a tourist hotel, and we were the first Best Western in the Philippines. And that one still, till today, remains closed. Mm. But for the local market, definitely, because the lockdowns have been, I guess, suppressed. So we are seeing an uptrend in that department. Mm-hmm.
This rebranding to something more, to sustainability, was this inspired by your other passion, which is farming, the King Tower Farm, the first aeroponic farm in the Philippines?
Yes. So a lot of people don't know this, but we've had, a provincial farmhouse for 30-something years already. And this is more of my home than the city. And people just see me as a car lover and a mechanic, but in reality, I've spent a lot of my childhood living in nature. And that's why when I started bee farming, I wanted a fast, surefire way to grow vegetables and flowers that we can feed the bees. But it actually evolved because we learned how to cultivate the soil properly, which meant the tower farm could now focus on just growing vegetables that we use to support the hotels also.
Oh.
So it definitely is a, working, good working balance where we can claim that we're true farm to table and pesticide free.
And I understand you renovated last year. How is the farm today? Is it back in 100% operations? I know that you're in your farm. You retreat to your
farm
when the cases are going up.
Well, you know what? This is home for us. We moved during the pandemic, and we love it here. We love having space, nature, fresh air, and being a farmer, seeing everything grow. It's such a great feeling. So, the greenhouse now is on its third revision. We decided to hire a contractor to do a massive renovation. We implemented shade netting, a higher headspace to eliminate more heat.
Mm-hmm.
We have extractor fans on the right side. We have cooling fins on the left side. And then we basically redid the nutrition system so that it goes through a refrigeration system before it actually feeds the towers, which means we can keep the optimum temperature for the vegetables at a good range. So plants don't like temperatures above 28 degrees Celsius. They like it lower, on the lower spectrum, which makes them flourish more.
Clearly, you're running a serious business there. It's not just a passion project. When do you see the day coming when this business, your agribusiness, becomes, you know, more than just a passion project, but a big money-making venture, a cash cow, when you start to supply other companies, not just your own hotels?
I think possibly. I do believe in the future, food scarcity will be definitely a big issue, because as the climate gets more unpredictable, it's going to be harder and harder to grow vegetables in a natural way. So indoor farming will be the next big thing. We are actually setting up a rooftop farm also in my head office in Malate, so that we can showcase to people that we are able to grow in different spaces. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the farm here is the flagship, but the city farm is to show people, yes, growing in different spaces. I'm actually tying up with Next Level Farms, which is run by Katrina Razon's team. And there, we're trying to be synergistic in a way, because we're sort of in the same industry, and we are, I guess, yeah, we're the underdogs in terms of farming, but in terms of productivity and yield, I think you can't beat the indoor farming, because we are able to control environment, pests, and just the yield and the nutrients of the vegetables. Mm-hmm. And sideline, I actually am starting a bamboo farm as well.
Ooh, all right. All right. We should invite you again when that bamboo project becomes a reality. I want to end with this. Angie, Pride Month just ended. We have come a long way. But what else do you think can the government do to harness and maximize the potential of this community, of the LGBT community? I understand there's an international research that estimates 10% of the world's population are theoretically part of the LGBT community, out or not, including as many as 12 million Filipinos. So what can the government do to support your group?
You know, honestly, Mimi, the Sochi bill, which is 20 years already of being blocked, needs to go through. It's a basic rights bill, and it will help, because you can't be terminated or discriminated based on your expression or your orientation. So that one, I think, is the biggest thing. Hopefully this current administration can help see that through already, because, yeah, it's been too long.
All right. And I know that you're going to be there at the forefront to champion this advocacy. Angie, it was a pleasure speaking with you. We look forward to more exciting discussions. Thank you for joining us. Have a great weekend.
Thank you, Mimi. Have a great weekend.
All right. All right, turning now to our blind item this morning. This is Prime Media Holdings. I think it was a giveaway when he said it was owned by a Marcos relative. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, stay informed and up to date with the latest news. Watch for free on iWantTFC. You may, of course, download the app or visit www.iwanttfc.com. And that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery, because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods.